Dear learners, today we shall discuss about unit 7 of your BA First Economics curriculum. Title of the unit is Theory of Production, and this is the first video of the unit. Title of this video is Basic Concepts in the Theory of Production. Dear learners, so far we have seen that just like a consumer has to take certain decisions regarding the basket of consumption, time and use of resources, etc., a producer or a firm also has to take certain decisions. Now let us consider the production decision of a firm. The production decision of a firm relates to four basic questions the firm faces, namely what to produce, how to produce, how much to produce, and for whom to produce. In this video, we shall basically discuss the concept of a production function, ISOC 1, and ISOC 1 map, and the marginal rate of technical substitution. Now let us explore the question the seller has in his mind first, what to produce. A firm will produce according to his perception of the consumer demand, whether to produce consumer goods or industrial goods. Say, a company may have to decide, the seller may have to decide what type of product it will produce, whether it will be consumer good or it will be industrial good. Now how to produce? Now after a firm decides what it will produce, the next question that it faces is how to produce. Okay? We have already discussed that there are four factors of production: land, labor, capital and entrepreneurship. But which type of technologies it will use, how much labor it will use, or what type of machineries it will use, this decision also he has to take. So how to produce? That's an important decision for the firm. How much to produce? The firm has to decide its production capacity and its production volume. Basically, for certain products, which are seasonal, okay, so production volume will vary based upon the season. Okay, that means for winter clothes, winter season is the best season to produce the goods. Okay, and for summer, during the summer, we need fans, electricity, fans, refrigerators, okay. So these types of goods will be produced in the summer. So how much to produce, the volume of production will also depend based on the nature of the product. And for whom to produce, a firm has to decide its target population and design its products accordingly so that it meets the needs of the target population. Now production function, what is the production function? A production function is a relation between inputs to the production process and the resulting output. A production function shows the highest output that a firm can produce for every specified combination of inputs. Let us assume that there are two inputs, factors of production, labor and capital. Now the production function can be written as Q is a function of within bracket L, K, that is Q is a function of L and K, where Q is the dependent variable which represents output or quantity, and both labor and capital L and K are independent variables. This relation simply states that output depends on inputs. Now what is an ISOC 1? An ISOC 1 or equal product line is a curve showing all possible combinations of inputs that yield the same level of output. This concept is analogous to consumer's indifference curve we have already discussed in our earlier units. So therefore it is also known as producer's indifference curve. That means the ISOC 1 is also called the producer's indifference curve. Now let us consider table 7.1 to understand this concept of ISOC 1. So here is a hypothetical example is there. So in this example you will see that the producer can produce 50 units of output with 1 unit of labor plus 30 units of capital, or it can produce the same level of output by employing 2 units of labor and 9 units of capital, or 3 units of labor and 6 units of capital, 4 units of labor plus 4 units of capital, or 5 units of labor and 3 units of capital. Now when these points are plotted on a graph paper and joined, they form an ISOC 1. Okay? In other words, an ISOC 1 is a locus of points showing alternative combinations of labor and capital which produce same level of output. Let us view the graphical shape of an ISOC 1. So it has been shown in figure 7.1. Okay? So the table 7.1 has been represented to the graph 7.1. So in the figure 7.1, you will see IQ1 represents the isoquant curve. Capital has been depicted in the y-axis, while the lever has been shown in the x-axis. Point 1 on the IQ1 curve represents the capital lever combination 1, which represents 13 units of capital and 1 unit of lever. Other combinations 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 4, 5 thus represent different units of capital and lever of the isoquant, as we discussed in table 7.1. Now let us discuss the concept of marginal rate of technical substitution. The rate at which one additional unit of a factor of production can be substituted for the other to obtain the same amount of output is known as the marginal rate of technical substitution. In other words, MRTS of labor for capital is the number of units of capital which can be replaced by one unit of labor, the quantity of output remaining the same. MRTS is the slope of the isoquant or the amount of one input, say capital, that a firm is able to give up in return for an additional unit of another unit L, that is labor, with no change in total output. That means total output remains the same. Another characteristics of MRTS LK, labor capital, is that MRTS, marginal rate of technical substitution, has a diminishing tendency. In other words, as the amount of labor units increasing, in the succeeding combinations, less and less units of capital are sacrificed to obtain the same output. So this marginal rate of technical substitution can be explained with the help of an example. Let us take table 7.2. Okay? The concept of marginal rate of technical substitution between labor and capital can be explained with the help of table 7.2. From table 7.2, it can be seen that 50 units of output can be produced by using 1 unit of labor and 15 units of capital. The same output can be produced by combination of B, okay, here you can see the different combination of labor and capital shown as A, B, C, D and E, okay. So by combination of B, which uses 2 units of labor and 11 units of capital, same amount of output can be produced by combination of C, D and E, which uses more and more units of labor but lesser and lesser units of capital. That is, in the different combinations of inputs, labor can be substituted for capital and yet we have the same amount of output. So let us represent this table in a graph form. Okay. Now in figure 7.3, you will see the isoquant IQ1 represents output level of 50. Okay. As we move downward from A to B, then AB1 units of capital is substituted by BB1 units of labor. Okay, in the graph you can see that. Similarly, while we move from B to C, BC1 units of capital is substituted by CC1 units of labor. Okay, again, if we come down from point C to D, you will find that CD1 units of capital is foregone to obtain EE1 units of capital. Okay, so this way you will see it. Okay, when more units of labor are used to compensate for the loss of the units of capital to maintain constant output, the marginal physical productivity of labor diminishes and the marginal physical productivity of capital increases. Therefore, MRTS diminishes as labor is substituted for capital. It makes the isoquant convex to the origin. Okay, you can see the convex slope of the curve here. So this is the first video. In the next video of this unit, we shall discuss about LCP substitution and other concepts of theory of production. Thank you.